If you have your Bibles tonight, I invite you to take them and let's go to the book of Revelation. Revelation chapter number 2, if you would. Final book in our Bible, Revelation chapter number 2 is where we'll find the text for tonight's message. Encourage you to be praying for our pastor. He's traveling and be in a meeting this week down in Tampa, Florida. The Global Independent Baptist Fellowship will be hosting this meeting. It's a nationwide meeting. We'll be hosting it this coming September. And certainly we'll be saying a lot more about that as the date draws nearer. Certainly as a church, we want to be good hosts and to be a blessing to folks who will be coming literally from all across the country and to be a part of this meeting. But you'll be praying for them as they're traveling. Be in that meeting. It starts tomorrow evening. So once you've found your place, if you'd stand as we reverence the Word of God, Revelation chapter number 2, we're going to begin reading in verse number 8, and we'll read down through verse number 11 of this second chapter here of the book of Revelation. You follow along with me as I read. The Bible says, "And unto the angel of the church in Smyrna write, These things saith, the first and the last, which was dead and is alive. I know thy works and tribulation and poverty, but thou art rich. And I know the blasphemy of them which say they are Jews and are not, but are the synagogue of Satan. Fear none of those things which thou shalt suffer. Behold, the devil shall cast some of you into prison, that ye may be tried, and ye shall have tribulation 10 days. Be thou faithful unto death, and I will give thee a crown of life. He that hath an ear, let him hear what the Spirit saith unto the churches. He that overcometh shall not be hurt of the second death." I want to preach tonight on this subject: things are not always what they seem. In these 3 or 4 verses, we find some seemingly contradictory statements that are found in these verses. I want you to notice them with me very quickly before I have you seated. Notice he says, "These things saith the first and the last." How can something be first and last? He goes on to say, which was dead and is alive. How can something be dead and now alive? Notice he goes on to say in verse number 9 about this church, the church at Smyrna, "I know thy poverty, but thou art rich." How can something be poor and rich at the same time? Go with me a little bit further in this passage. "I know the blasphemy of them which say they are the Jews and are not." How can someone say they're Jewish or be a Jew and yet not be a Jew at the same time? Notice lastly, the end of verse number 11, "He that overcometh shall not be hurt of the second death." How can someone die and not be hurt by it? Things are not always what they seem. Father, would you bless our time together in your word? May you speak to our hearts tonight as we open this chapter and open this book. We will certainly give you honor and praise and glory for everything that will be accomplished through the preaching of the Word of God tonight, we pray in Jesus' name. Amen. Thank you. You may be seated. Things are not always what they seem. When I was a high school student, I was a part of our high school choir. And that may sound a little humorous to some of you, but I was. I was in the high school choir, and I remember being a senior And I remember learning and hearing about the need for seniors to lead and to kind of gather those that are under them and lead in the right direction. And I remember I went to choir one day. I'll never forget this as long as I live. And I remember sitting in the choir rehearsal room, and I thought, I need to be a leader here. And I know one way that I can lead is by singing out. A lot of times teenagers, especially teenage young men, they're singing in a choir, but their lips are hardly moving, And I thought, man, I'm gonna lead in this choir, and I'm gonna really sing out. And so I did, man. I was singing out. And I thought I was nailing it, man. I thought, this is leadership right here. And I remember just sitting in my seat, and I was kind of puffed up with pride a little bit. And I'm looking around at other people, and they're hardly singing, and I am just absolutely belting it out. And it wasn't long into that rehearsal session in which our choir teacher came, and he just kind of caught me, and he said, "Hey, Peter," he said, "when class is over, I'd like to see you in my office." Oh, man, my head exploded. Oh, he is going to tell me how amazing I am. He is going to tell me that I am just one of the best singers that he's ever had in this choir, and how thankful he is for my leadership and my influence in encouraging these other students to sing out. And I remember the rest of the choir, man, I sang even louder. I thought, this is incredible. I am going to be heaped with praise when I get into his office. And I just knew that this was the way that this was going to go down. I mean, I did not walk into that man's office that day. I strutted in. I mean, I was as proud as I could possibly be. I mean, my like I said, it's amazing I even got in the door. My head was so big. And I remember I walked in and I sat down and he looked at me and he said, "Hey," he said, I really want to thank you for singing out." And I thought, "Here we go. Here it comes. Brace yourself. This is going to be amazing." And he said, you know, "You're really singing out loud there, and I really appreciate that. That's great." He said, but you were really flat. And he said, you weren't hitting the notes just right. And he says, "The result of that, you were leading everybody else astray." He said, "Every other guy was kind of following your lead. And he said, "Because you were so off, the rest of them were off as well." And I got to tell you, man, I mean, I went from like cloud nine, man, so super proud of myself to, you know, I mean, just having to pick myself up off the ground and walk out of that office and make my way back over. I got to, that was a humiliating experience. He even said to me, he said, "Next time," he said, "why don't you just tone it down just a little bit, you know, and not sing out as loud as you were singing earlier today." And you know, I mean, my hopes and dreams of a musical career were dashed, you know, that afternoon. I promise you that. Things are not always what they seem. Sometimes we think, we assume something's going to happen, or we assume based upon what we know, when the way that we see things, that they're going to be a certain way, but things are not always as they seem. If we come to Revelation chapter number 2, we certainly find this theme played out in the 4 verses that we've just read regarding the church there at Smyrna. Now, this church at Smyrna was known as a fearful church. Dr. John Phillips, in his reference book on the book of Revelation, talks about the church at Smyrna, and he refers to them as the fearful church. This church would soon be facing intense persecution, and some would even literally die for their faith. And as a result, great fear had enveloped this congregation. The Bible does not tell us how large this church was, whether it was a large church or whether it was a small church. I would assume, based upon the pressure that they were under and the persecution that they were enduring, that perhaps it was just a small body of believers. And yet, I want you to know something. This was a great church. For God does not judge churches and how great they are based upon their attendance or the offering or how big the auditorium is and how many classes they have and ministries that they have going every night of the week. No. God bases the greatness of a church on the faithfulness of its people and on their love for Christ and their growth and their passion to serve Him. And we're all for a growing church. And I want to see this church grow and go forward. And I think any pastor of any church is going to want to see a church moving in a right direction. But numbers are not always the defining characteristic of a church. In fact, of the 7 churches that Christ writes to in chapters 2 and 3 of Revelation, there are only 2 churches in which He has nothing negative to say about them. And one of those churches here is the church at Smyrna, the other being the church there at Philadelphia. And so we find here this church at Smyrna, and the evil pawns of Satan had set their sights on this poor little church, intending to completely destroy and eliminate them. The vultures of darkness were circling, eager to feast on the remains of this body of Christ. But we are shown a glimpse of great faith in this church family that enabled them to survive these attacks and to listen to live on long after anyone thought that they would. Remember, things are not always as they seem. And I want us to consider this church at Smyrna tonight and the things that the Lord says to them. They are a tremendous example to us that one can be down, but not out. One can be up against it, so to speak, but they can still emerge victorious. With God, all things are possible, and things are not always what they seem. Perhaps maybe you came into the service tonight, and perhaps maybe you're feeling down about yourself. Now, you're feeling down about where you are in your Christian life, and maybe there's good reason for that. But I remind you that that's not the end of the story. If God wanted the story to be over, it would be over at this point. But God's given you life and God's given you breath. And just because you're down doesn't necessarily mean that you have to be out. And just because you anticipate a trial in the near future, maybe you're looking at a situation in which you don't know how you're going to overcome it and how you're going to get through it, I want you to understand things are not always what they seem. Number one, consider things are not always what they seem for the people of God. Notice verse number 9. He says this to the church at Smyrna. I know thy works and tribulation and poverty, but thou art rich. You see, you and I look at things a little differently than the way God looks at them. You see, we have the advantage or the opportunity to look at things from a horizontal perspective. In other words, you and I can kind of only see our lives from one angle. But I remind you that there's another perspective that is alive in our world tonight, and that is a perspective from up above. It's a heavenly perspective. It's a divine perspective. And God looks down, and God sometimes sees things differently than you and I see things. And we consider this church at Smyrna, and as they looked at themselves from their perspective, consider the problems of life that they saw. God saw them too, but he saw things a little differently than they did. He said, I know thy works. He said, I know thy tribulation, and I know thy poverty. A little bit later in verse number 10, he seems to indicate that there's some fear that's alive and present in this church. And he even talks about death that is soon to come for some because of their faith and trust in Jesus Christ. And the church at Smyrna, they could only see those things. They could only see the tribulation and the poverty. They could only see the fear and the death. Those were the things that they were tempted to focus on. And isn't that oftentimes how life is? So many times all we can see are the problems. We miss out on the blessings and the good things that God has put into our lives. And we seem to just focus on the negative. Do you ever find yourself doing that? I know I do. So often I have a hard time being able to see the blessings of life. You know, one of the things that helps me immensely is visiting the hospitals. I go to the hospital and visit folks that are laying there with a great infirmity and great illness. And boy, it reminds me of just how blessed I am. That's helpful to me. I want to encourage you. Perhaps you tend to look down on yourself and the issues of life, and you tend to see yourself in a certain light. And I remind you maybe to use some of your time to minister to someone who's worse off than you. He'll give you a different perspective on life. That's why the bus ministry often is so helpful to us, especially to our teenagers. Sometimes our teenagers look at life and, well, I can't have this, and then I don't have this, and, you know, that sort of thing. But you know what? Some of these teenagers, they can work on some bus routes, and they can see, you know, I may not have the nicest shoes and the nicest video game systems, the nicest TV. I may not live in the nice neighborhood, but you know what I do have? I have godly parents. I have a mom and dad who love me, who care about me, who are concerned about me, and it can change their perspective on life. But so often, we just focus on the problems. And God says, I want you to know something. The problems are real. They do exist. But just because there are problems doesn't necessarily mean that impending defeat and doom and gloom is on its way, because things are not always as they seem. And I want you to have some hope tonight. Perhaps you're in this room, you're in this auditorium, and life is filled with problems, and you've got issues, and perhaps you're just so frustrated and so down in despair about the problems of life. And perhaps if God were to speak to you tonight, he would say, yes, I see those problems, I see those issues, but I see something else. For in this passage of Scripture, God does not just list the problems. For we find a little parenthetical phrase right after he says and lists the problems. Did you see that? He said, I know thy works and tribulation and poverty, but thou art rich. We see the perspective of the Lord in this passage. See, this church was certainly poor in a material sense. But listen, from a higher position, another perspective is seen. Have you ever flown in an airplane? You get up in that airplane and, boy, everything just looks so different, doesn't it? You know, when you're down on the ground, the world seems so enormous. You know, the road that you're on, it just seems like it's never going to end. But boy, you get up in that airplane, I mean, that road just looks like a tiny little thing there. And I mean, you could see as far as the eye can see. There's something about being up higher. There's a perspective that's found there that's not found anywhere else. And unfortunately, you and I, we live our lives down here on this earth. We live life on the ground, but we have a God in heaven who sees things from a different perspective. And he says, I understand that you're poor in a material sense. You don't have a lot of money. And perhaps maybe they were poor in numbers as well. Perhaps there weren't that many of them. But God says, I want you to know something. I see something differently than what you see. And I know that there's some poverty there, but I want you to also know that I see some wealth here as well. This church, Jesus looks at them, and he doesn't just see a physical poverty, but he sees a wealth of spirituality. You know, God has allowed me to travel some, and I'm always amazed when I visit third world countries to see the way that they live and the things that they have to deal with. Unless you've actually been there, it is absolutely impossible to describe. I could do my best, but you couldn't possibly get a glimpse unless you actually went to those places. So a couple of years ago, we were in Kenya, and Brother Mickey had a day set aside in which we were going to go out and we were going to pass out literature, flyers, tracts, and then we were going to hold some outdoor Bible clubs and that sort of thing. And I remember as we were getting ready to go, he said, "Now look," he said, "you know, as you go out, understand that there are going to be children that are just going to flock to you." And he said, one of the things that they're going to want to do is they're going to want to get as many tracts as they can. He says, they play this game. And the goal is to collect as many tracts as possible. He says, this could sound really weird. He says, but, you know, just be careful how many of these tracts you hand out. I thought to myself, that is really, really strange. But he was exactly right. These kids just kept coming. And the goal was to see how many tracts they could collect. You know, they don't have toys like you and I have toys. Now, they don't have the games that our kids have. They don't have the video games that our kids enjoy. And there's not a lot of wealth. But you know what I noticed in Kenya, especially among the believers? I noticed a joy that sometimes is not present in the United States of America. Even amongst the people of God. Here are people who have absolutely nothing. They've never owned a car. Listen, they don't even have their own personal bathroom. Most of them do not. Most of them live in houses in which there's a long line of houses, and they just share a restroom facility with everybody else that lives in that community. Most of them don't have electricity, and they don't have running water, and they don't have the things that you and I associate with the conveniences of life. And we would think that these people would be miserable, that these people would be sorry, that these people would be absolutely just full of depression and discouragement and frustration. And yet amongst the people of God, I've never seen smiles like I've seen there. Now, how can that be? Because listen, there's more to life than just the physical, material elements. The problem is we live in a culture and in a country that is so obsessed with these things. We base happiness on the newest toy and how much money we have in the bank and how much money we have in the mutual funds and the 401ks. And I want you to know something. There's a different perspective. There's a different view of life. And God gives it to us in this passage of Scripture. While these people may not have been dining in nice restaurants and vacationing on the beach or dwelling in nice neighborhoods, things still weren't what they seemed. And Christ commends them by telling them they aren't as poor as most would assume them to be. He said, I want you to know something. He says, I know your poverty, but I also want you to know something. You're wealthier than you have any idea. You are actually rich. We might ask the question, well, in what ways were they wealthy? You know, the Bible doesn't specifically state it here, but we can assume that they were wealthy in grace, in love, in joy, and peace. I mean, the list goes on and on. You find in Galatians 5, 22 and 23, the fruit of the Spirit, listen, which only the Spirit can produce. In other words, to have this fruit in your life, you must be a born-again Christian. You must have the Holy Spirit living inside of you if you're going to produce these elements of life found in Galatians 5, 22 and 23. You know, if we could choose to be wealthy in one area or another, I think probably most of us would choose the first. We would choose the financial wealth. And we would justify it like this. Well, if I had financial wealth, I could give more money to the work of God. I could do more for the cause of Christ. And if I had more wealth, I wouldn't be so consumed with stressing about paying my bills. And we just assumed that would help us to be better off if we had more financial wealth. And we could justify it in a lot of ways. But you know what I think? I think that if God would give us the right answer, that the answer would be, Lord, help me to be wealthy in a spiritual sense. Lord, help me to be rich in grace and in love, in joy and in peace? For even if I'm poverty stricken here in this world, I can still be rich. And so God gives this perspective of things are not always as they seem. Listen, you may not have much of this world's goods, but that doesn't mean you don't have a wealth this world knows nothing about. If we could just somehow, some way, see things from God's perspective, we would be reminded. We may not be the wealthiest church here in Northeast Ohio, and we may not be the wealthiest people, but there's a richness, there's a wealth that God has given us that the world knows nothing about. Notice, secondly, things are not always what they seem for the adversaries of the people of God. For in verse number 9, we find, "And I know the blasphemy of them which say they are Jews and are not, but are the synagogue of Satan." Not only are things not always what they seem for the people of God, but they're not always what they seem for the adversaries of the people of God as well. For we see in this passage of Scripture, number one, we see the dominant control of the adversaries in this passage. He says, "I know the blasphemy of them." You know, the wicked world is seemingly in control over everything, aren't they? But doesn't it seem as though the wicked in this world are in charge of everything? They control our media. In many cases, they're in control of politics. Man, they just seem to be in control of the entire world. And these people are powerful and they're eager to blaspheme and to defame the name of Christ and those who find their hope in Christ. And listen, things were no different 2,000 years ago. The church at Smyrna was really no different than us here in this day and age, in which they were dwelling underneath the control of people who were dominant, and yet they were the adversaries. And these people seem to be able to say and do just about anything, and they seem to do it without fear of judgment or punishment. I want us to use our Bibles a little bit tonight, and I want us to take our Bibles, go to the 73rd Psalm. Would you go with me there very quickly? And notice that this problem isn't even 2,000 years old. This problem is much older than that. For in Psalm 73, we find Asaph, who writes this psalm. And he seems to indicate some of these same issues and problems. And notice what he says in Psalm 73. He says, "Truly God is good to Israel, even to such as are of a clean heart. But as for me, my feet were almost gone. My steps had well nigh slipped, for I was envious at the foolish when I saw the prosperity of the wicked. For there are no bands in their death, but their strength is firm. They are not in trouble as other men, neither are they plagued like other men. Therefore pride compasseth them about as a chain. Violence covereth them as a garment. Their eyes stand out with fatness. They have more than heart could wish. They are corrupt and speak wickedly concerning oppression. They speak loftily. They set their mouth against the heavens, and their tongue walketh through the earth. Therefore his people return hither, and waters of a full cup are wrung out to them. And they say, how doth God know? And is there knowledge in the Most High? Behold, these are the ungodly, whose prosper in the world they increase in riches." And I got to be honest with you, I feel like that same passage could be written today. In many respects, I feel like the attitude of the wicked and the ungodly has not changed a bit. And in some respects, I feel like those of us that are believers, we almost have the same heart and spirit of Asaph as he writes this passage. Then we look around and we say, how can this be? Man, we want to serve the Lord and we want to follow the Lord and we want to desire the Lord and go after him. And yet it seems as though we just have problem after problem and issue after issue. And yet the world just seems to party on and have no repercussion, and they seem to have no problems, and their hearts are lifted up with pride. And because there doesn't seem to be anything stopping them, they take it to the fullest extent. Notice Psalm 35, if you would. Go back to Psalm 35. Asaph speaks in Psalm 73, but in Psalm 35, we see David speaking very similarly. Notice what he says. He says, "But as for me," verse number 13, "but as for me, when they were sick," speaking of his enemies, speaking of the unrighteous, "but as for me, when they were sick, my clothing was sackcloth. I humbled my soul with fasting, and my prayer returned into mine own bosom." In other words, he says, when my enemies were sick, man, I was grieved by it. I didn't celebrate. I didn't rejoice. I clothed myself in sackcloth. I did everything I could to try to identify with them. Notice verse number 14. "I behaved myself as though he had been my friend or brother. I bowed down heavily as one that mourneth for his mother. But listen, but in mine adversity, they rejoiced and gathered themselves together. Yea, the abjects gathered themselves together against me. And I knew it not. They did tear me and cease not with hypocritical mockers and feasts. They gnashed upon me with their teeth. Look at verse number 17. Lord, how long wilt thou look on? Rescue my soul from their destructions, my darling from the lions. He says, man, this is so frustrating to me. He said, when my enemies were sick, I tried to treat them with kindness. I tried to love on them as if I would a brother or a friend. He said, but when the roles were reversed and I was going through a period of adversity, he said, they gathered themselves together and they celebrated and they rejoiced. He says, it just doesn't seem right. And he says, Lord, how long are you going to allow this to continue? In much the same way, this church at Smyrna were looking around and they were seeing their persecutors. They were watching these that were blaspheming them and blaspheming their God. And this church at Smyrna is cowering in fear because of the dominant control of their adversaries. The second psalm starts with heathen raging and kings of the earth coming together against God and his anointed. It seems as though we are bombarded on every side by the dominant control of our adversaries. But listen, I remind you, things are not always what they seem. You might look around and you might see the wicked prospering and the evil men celebrating while the righteous are quiet and fearful and concerned about their future. I want you to know something. God sees things from a different perspective. God has written the end of this book, and we know how it all ends. In fact, we're preaching from Revelation chapter number 2 tonight. Most of us are familiar with the end result of the evil and the wicked. They may have their time of rejoicing for a season or for a moment, but in the end, God is going to make everything right. We see the dominant control of the adversaries. Notice, secondly, the deceitful characterization of the adversaries. Go with me back to Revelation chapter number 2, and we find another contradiction here in this passage of Scripture. He says, I know the blasphemy, verse number 9, of them which say they are Jews and are not. The deceitful characterization of the adversaries. You know, the church at Smyrna had been mocked as they sought to follow Christ by those who claimed to know who God really was. Now, the truth is that these people may have been actually Jews in origin, but from God's vantage point and from God's perspective, they were not worthy to bear that Jewish name. In other words, God not necessarily is saying they're actually not Jews in blood, but God is saying in the worthiness to carry that name, these men and these women who are carrying on this way, they don't deserve that name. They're not Jews in the truest sense of the word, maybe in blood, but certainly not in faith and in belief. You know, we live in a world in which I feel like the narrative has been completely stolen from us as people. I don't know if you see this, but it seems as though the world wants to celebrate love and they want to be the ones who are so loving and so accepting, and yet they look at us and they call us the hate mongers. The people of God. The people of God, you know, the Bible tells us that God is love, and one of the fruits of the Spirit, in fact, the very first one is love. And yet the world has stolen this concept or this idea from us. And the vast majority of the world looks at churches that preach like we preach and that carry on like we carry on. And they look at us as hate mongers. They look at us as trying to rain on everybody's parade. And they have completely stolen the narrative and they have deceived the world into thinking that we are the ones that hate. I take it a step further and I think to myself, the world has claims to be the tolerant ones, don't they? And they look at us and they label us as the bigots. Oh man, you guys are bigoted. You don't want people to love and you don't want people to marry whoever they want to marry. And you guys are just hate mongers. You're just a bunch of bigots. You guys are filled with prejudice and filled with hate. The world has been very successful at deceiving itself and others. And we are now to the point that was predicted in the book of Isaiah, in which the Bible says, woe unto them that call evil good and good evil. And we are living in that day and age in which the views that you and I espouse, holy, righteous views about the world and relationships and the way that things ought to be carried on, we're considered evil. We're the hate mongers. We're the bigots. And those that are living lifestyles that are contrary, listen, to even human nature itself, well, those are the loving ones. Those are the tolerant ones. And I remind you, things were no different for the church at Smyrna. For the church at Smyrna was mocked because of their belief. You guys can't possibly be real Jews and believe in this Jesus Christ. Jesus Christ was a blasphemer. He was a mocker. He was not who he said he was. And yet the Heavenly Father looks down from heaven and says, these people who claim to be Jews, oh, they're not really Jews. Oh, they may be in a blood sense. They may be in their line and their descendants, but they're not worthy to bear that name. And just because somebody says they're loving doesn't necessarily mean that they are. And just because someone says that they're tolerant doesn't necessarily mean that they are. And just because somebody points at us and says, you guys are hate mongers and you guys are bigots, ought not to cause us to vary from our beliefs. Because I remind you, things are not always what they seem. And there is a different perspective than the perspective that is seen here on this earth. Number three, notice the distinct condemnation of the adversaries. A moment ago, the adversaries are rejoicing and they're celebrating. They're carrying on, and the people of God are cowering in fear. But God finishes verse number 9 up and says this, but are the synagogue of Satan. Would you take your Bibles and go with me to Revelation chapter number 20? I want you to see the end result of Satan. I don't know about you, but I can't hardly read Revelation chapter number 20 and not get excited. For the Bible says in verse number 7, when the 1,000 years are expired, Satan shall be loosed out of his prison, shall go out to deceive the nations which are in the four quarters of the earth, Gog and Magog, to gather them together to battle, the number of whom is as the sand of the sea. And they went up on the breadth of the earth and compassed the camp of the saints about in the beloved city. And fire came down from God out of heaven and devoured them. Notice verse number 10. And the devil that deceived them was cast into the lake of fire and brimstone, where the beast and the false prophet are, and shall be tormented day and night forever. Oh, if that doesn't cause you to shout, if that doesn't cause you to rejoice, I don't know what will. God tells us at the end of time, fire is going to come down from heaven. He's going to destroy the enemies of God's people. And that God is going to take the devil, the serpent that was first seen in Genesis chapter number 3. And he's been terrorizing people, namely the people of God, all of this time. God's going to take that devil. He's going to take that serpent. He's going to take Lucifer. He's going to take the prince of the power of the air. He's going to take the accuser of the brethren. He's going to take that old Satan, and he's going to throw him into the lake of fire. The Bible says, listen, where he shall be tormented forever. Oh, what a great day that's going to be. What a marvelous thought to think that this devil who troubles us and bothers us, and he's tempting us at every moment, and he's always a thorn in our side and a thorn in our flesh, that the day is coming in which this devil will be cast into the lake of fire forever. You know, we look around and we see those that are celebrating and those that are mocking God and those that are rejoicing in the hurt and the suffering of God's people. And while I don't rejoice in the fact that judgment is coming their way, we ought never to rejoice. It's such a serious thing for a human soul to spend eternity in a place called hell. I remind you that God distinctly condemns the adversaries of God's people. And even though they may not receive that condemnation just yet, they're still under that condemnation. And they cannot escape it as long as they don't repent of their sins. So understand, things are not always what they seem for the adversaries of God's people. We look around and we see politicians. We see judges who have made terrible decisions as far as from our vantage point is concerned that directly violate the principles of Scripture and God's Word. We're bothered by it and we're troubled by it. We see profanity and we see immorality and we see blasphemy and we see wickedness on every side. Perhaps we want to just throw in the towel. Get frustrated with God because it just doesn't seem like those people are receiving the just reward for what they're doing. And yet I remind you that things are not always what they seem. Notice last thing, we'll be done. Things are not always what they seem for God's people. Things are not always what they seem for the adversaries of God's people. Lastly, number three, things are not always what they seem for the suffering of the people of God. If you look in verse number 10 again of Revelation chapter number 2. Jesus says this to his church, fear none of those things which thou shalt suffer. Can I say the letter from Christ to the church at Smyrna proves the following points regarding the suffering in the people of God. And it may be tonight that you're suffering. Maybe that you're going through something that maybe nobody else understands. Maybe even nobody else knows about. It's troubling to you. But can I share with you three astounding truths about suffering in the people of God? Number one, a Christian can suffer without fear. Did you notice that in verse number 10? It says, fear none of those things which thou shalt suffer. You know, this is a command. This is not a suggestion. This is Christ telling his church, you do this. He's saying, you need to fear none of these things which thou shalt suffer. You know, Christ commands the church to do this, and he would not have commanded them to do something that they were incapable of doing. You know, perhaps they were incapable of doing it, but listen, with Christ, they could truly face their suffering, face their tribulation, their persecution without fear. For I remind you, Philippians 4:13, I can do all things through Christ, which strengtheneth me. You know, I don't know what lies in front of you. I don't know what you have to deal with. I don't know how you're suffering tonight, but listen, God knows. God sees it. Christ is well aware. God maybe sent me here to tell you tonight that you can go through this trial, whatever it is, you can go through it without fear. It is possible. As we yield our lives to him, a Christian can suffer without fear. Notice, secondly, a Christian can be faithful unto death. Notice verse number 10 again. It says, the devil shall cast some of you into prison that ye may be tried, and ye shall have tribulation 10 days. Notice again, another command, be thou faithful unto death. Oh, that we would determine to live our lives as Paul did in 2 Timothy chapter number 4. He says, my time is now here. I am ready to be offered. I have fought a good fight. I have finished my course. I have kept the faith. In other words, what Paul was saying, I have been faithful even unto death. You know, who knows? Who knows what this future holds for the people of God? But there's no doubt that there could be in our future, there could be some level of persecution. And it could get very, very intense. But you know what? We can be faithful unto death. You may be going through something that maybe is not necessarily persecution from the outside world because of your faith, but it's truly a persecution for you. It's a tribulation, whatever it is. Listen, you can still be faithful unto death. Lastly, can I say the last thought about a Christian and the suffering of the people of God and things are not always what they seem? Listen, a Christian can die and still live. Look in verse number 11. Look in verse number 10. It says, be thou faithful unto death, and I will give thee a crown of life. I don't know about you, but in order to receive a crown of life, I got to be alive to be able to receive it, right? Look at verse number 11. He says this. He that hath an ear, let him hear what the Spirit saith unto the churches. He that overcometh shall not be hurt of the second death. The Bible very clearly talks about two deaths. It also talks about two births. I was in my barber, visiting my barber this last Wednesday, I believe, if I remember correctly. And I walked in. He knows I'm a pastor, And he asked me a couple questions. He's Catholic, and he asked me a couple questions. We kind of talk a little bit here and there. And finally, as I was sitting in the chair, he kind of looks around the corner at me, and he says, hey, tell me, are you one of those born-again Christians? Just like that. I guess the Catholics don't believe in being a born-again Christian. And I said, I absolutely am. Jesus said, you cannot see the kingdom of God unless you're born again. And it was almost like Nicodemus. He said, well, how in the world can I be born a second time? Can you believe he asked me that? I mean, he did. Right there in the barber's chair, you know. And I had a captive audience. I was able to share with him how you and I can be born a second time. The Bible talks about two births. The Bible also talks about two deaths. The first death is perhaps maybe the death that maybe we fear the most. Because it's the physical death. It's that which we see and that which we know. But God says, don't fear the physical death. That's not that big of a deal. Jesus said that to his followers. He said, don't fear man that's able to kill your body. He said, that's not the end of the world. He said, what you need to fear is you need to fear him that's able to kill body and destroy your soul in a place called hell. The Bible says for believers, for Christians, listen, we can die, but we can still live. We can die a physical death, but we don't have to be hurt by the second death. Then when we die that physical death, if we're faithful unto death, God, listen, God will give us a crown of life. Things are not always what they seem for the suffering of the people of God. Go down through history and we see many men and women that have shed their blood. Listen, they have given their lives for the cause of Christ. And the world has mocked and they have celebrated and they have laughed and they've looked at those people and they said, what a waste! What a waste that they would give their life, that they would shed their blood for their faith. How could they have been so foolish? How could they have been so short-sighted? God looks at it from a different perspective. And he looks at the man who's lived 95 years. And he's accomplished all that there is to accomplish. And God says this, but what shall it profit a man if he gain the whole world and lose his own soul? I remind you, Cleveland Baptist Church, things are not always what they seem. For the people of God, for the adversaries of God's people, and for the suffering of the people of God, things are not always what they seem. Would you bow your heads with me? Our heads are bowed and